Exodus chapter 2, please. In the original Hebrew canon, Exodus is called Shemot. Shemot. Literally, the book of the names. Shemot. Exodus closes in chapter 2 with, opens with what would transpire concerning Moses and his birth. Now, a man from the house of Levi went and married a daughter of Levi. This was a priestly family. Most Jews were not in any sense particularly observant at this time, but being from a priestly family, it is not unlikely that Moses would have underwent Brit Milah, circumcision, ritual circumcision. Most Jews were not doing this at that time, but a priestly family may have, which is how, of course, they may have identified him as a Hebrew baby. I'll read through this text, pointing out the nuances of the original Hebrew, and then at the end we'll try, by the Lord's grace, to explain what it means for us. A man from the house of Levi went and married a daughter of Levi. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was beautiful, she hid him 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got him a wicker basket and covered it over with pitch. Then she put the child into it and set it among the reeds by the Nile. His sister stood at a distance to find out what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came to bathe at the Nile with her maidens walking alongside the Nile. And she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid, and she brought it to her. When she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the boy was crying, and she had pity on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go ahead." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed him. The child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she named him Moses and said, "Because I have drawn him out of the water." Moses, actually, it's related to an ancient Egyptian word, ma'ashe, to draw out, to draw out. The first thing we have to understand about this text is the Messiah would be a prophet like Moses. According to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verse 18, the Messiah would be a prophet like Moses. When the Holy Spirit inspired this to be written, he's trying to show Moses as a foreshadow of the Messiah who would come. Moses was hidden from a wicked king who was killing all of the Jewish male babies. He was protected for a season in Egypt through the faith of his parents. He was protected from a wicked king through the faith of his parents, finding refuge for a season in Egypt. And so Jesus would be saved in Egypt, protected in Egypt through the faith of his parents from a wicked king. Moses is foreshadowing what would happen to the Messiah, because the Messiah would be a prophet like Moses. Secondly, the word there for wicker basket is not a very good translation as such. It is in fact the same word in the Hebrew text used for Noah's Ark. Used for Noah's Ark. The idea of being pitched within and without, the word there in the original Hebrew is the same word used for the Ark of Noah. It is the same imagery. God's people being saved out of calamity through the water. God's people finding salvation through the water. This is a recurrent motif in the Bible. We see it with Noah, we certainly see it with Moses, and then we see it in the Exodus of the Jews. God's people being saved through the water. And of course, in our salvation, in 1 Corinthians 10, through the waters of baptism, God's people are saved through the water. This motif is reiterated continually throughout the scripture. At a time of calamity, God brings his people safely through the water. The word here is the same word for ark. Moses is adopted. We read about Moses' history in Egypt in two places. The New Testament tells us that Moses was trained in the wisdom of Pharaoh before he was trained in the wisdom of God. He was trained in the wisdom of Pharaoh before he was trained in the wisdom of God. He received the finest education Egypt, at that time, the apex of human culture, was able to give him. Secondly, we read about it in Antiquities of the Jews. We know from Josephus that Moses was a prince and a judge of Egypt. He was a prince and a judge of Egypt. He was a general in Pharaoh's army. He was an aristocrat. He was a member of the royal family and the royal court. By adoption, he was the grandson of Pharaoh, legally a member of the royal family. He was a person of power, privileged position, a general in the army, a prince, and a judge. He was a man of some means, some education. We read about this in Antiquities. The story then continues. Verse 11. Now it came about in those days, when Moses had grown up, that he went out to the brethren, and he looked on their hard labors, and he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his brethren. So he looked this way and that, and when he saw that there was no one around, he struck down the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. He went out the next day, and behold, two Hebrews were fighting with each other. And he said to the offender, "Why are you striking your companion?" But he said, "Who made you a prince or a judge over us?" Bearing in mind, in fact, he was a prince and a judge over the Egyptians. "Are you intending to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" Then Moses was afraid and said, "Surely the matter has become known." When Pharaoh heard of this matter, he tried to kill Moses. But Moses fled from the presence of Pharaoh and settled in the land of Midian. And he sat down by a well. Now the priest of Midian had seven daughters, and they came to draw water and filled the troughs to water their father's flock. Then the shepherds came and drove them away, but Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. And when they came to Reuel, their father, he said, "Why have you come back so soon today?" So they said, "An Egyptian delivered us from the hand of the shepherds. And what is more, he even drew water for us and watered the flock." And he said to his daughters, "Where is he then? Why is it that you have left the man? Invite him to have something to eat." Moses was willing to dwell with the man, and he gave his daughter Zipporah to Moses. Then she gave birth to a son, and he named him Gershom, for he said, "I have been a sojourner in a foreign land." Let's begin at the beginning. Once more, the Holy Spirit is inspiring this to be written in such a way as to show Moses prefigures the Messiah. We read in John chapter 1, verse 12, that he came to his own, but his own would not believe. But Jesus prophesied a time would come when the Jews would say to him from Jerusalem, "Baruch haba b'shem Adonai." Romans 11 tells us the natural branches will be grafted back in again. As the first Christians were Jews, the last Christians will be Jews. We see that will happen in Zechariah chapter 12, climaxing with the return of Christ when they look upon him who they have pierced. In other words, the first time Jesus came to save the Jews, they rejected him. So he went to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles accepted him. It's the second time he comes to save Israel and the Jews that they accept him during a time of great calamity. When Jesus comes to save his own, they reject him. He goes to the Gentiles, they accept him. Then, at a time of great calamity, he comes to the Jews, and the second time they accept him. And so Moses, the Messiah, would be a prophet like Moses. Moses comes and tries to save or help save his own people. They reject him. At the first coming, they reject him. He goes to the Gentiles, non-Jews, accept him. It's the second time he comes to save Israel that they accept him, howbeit at a time of great calamity, of great tribulation for them. The events of the Exodus, of course, prefigure the book of Revelation. Those same judgments that God brought on Egypt, commemorated in the Passover Haggadah, Hoshek, darkness, Dam, blood, Tzvadaya, frogs, you take the drops of wine and throw them out and count out the judgments. They are recapitulated in the book of Revelation. What happened in the Exodus is a microcosm and a foreshadow of what will happen to the entire planet. The way that Pharaoh's magicians counterfeited the miracles of Moses and Aaron is, of course, a picture of the way the Antichrist and false prophet are going to counterfeit the miracles of Jesus and his witnesses. That's what the text is trying to show us. Moses is a prophet like Jesus. They'll accept him at the second time, at a time of great tribulation, with the advent of Antichrist and so forth. Pharaoh was a man worshipped as God by the Egyptians, just as the Antichrist is going to be a man who's worshipped as God. Now, of course, the Exodus is a picture of the rapture and resurrection. That's why they brought Joseph's bones with them out of Egypt. The dead in Christ rise first, we come out together. And so, the first time Moses comes to save the Jews, they don't recognize him. But when he comes the second time, in a time of great calamity, they do. Same it is with Jesus. In between the two comings, the Gentiles accept him. This is what St. Paul and what Jesus calls the time of the Gentiles, what the prophet Daniel calls, the time of the Gentiles. This is the time of the Gentiles. He comes back and goes back to his own. The daughters of Reuel call him an Egyptian. They look upon him as a non-Jew, as an Egyptian. And so it is, most people who are Jewish, objectively, they'll know Jesus as a Jew, but they look upon him as a non-Jew. And even many Christians like to forget the fact that he's Jewish. They give him blonde hair or blue eyes, they make a silly Italian movie or something like this, forgetting the Jewishness of Christ. He came into his own. Moses was seen as an Egyptian, as a non-Jew. And so Jesus is seen both by Jew and Gentile, popularly as a non-Jew, but that is simply not the case. Reuel has two names. Reuel is also called Jethro. And the Druze sect, the Druze religion, who are Israeli, but not Muslims and not Jewish. They're Israeli, but neither Muslims or Jewish. They live in Galilee, Lebanon, and on the Golan Heights. They look to the same person, Jethro, Reuel, as the patriarch of their religion. That's what their claim is. If you come with us to Israel, we'll show you Druzes. They look back to him as their prophet and their founder. The Jews were the first monotheistic nation, but there were always monotheistic individuals who knew there was one true God. We know that one of the kings of Nineveh was a monotheist. We know that Akhenaten in Egypt, the pharaoh, was a monotheist. There were always monotheists. People could always know there's one true God. You always get this story when you witness to people, but what about the native on the island who never heard the gospel? How can God send him to hell? We are imagio Dei beings. The book of Romans tells us everybody can know there's one true God because we're made in his image and likeness. Everybody can know they have sin. Everybody can know that sin must be atoned for and they have to repent. Everybody can know you should treat other people the way you want others to treat you. The Jews were the monotheistic nation, but there were always monotheistic individuals, Jethro being one of them. Story begins when Moses comes to his own people. He comes as a prince and a judge of Egypt, but his own people reject him. Who made you a prince and a judge over us? This story very much would remind me of what I saw in my own youth. As you can tell by my Robert De Niro, Bugs Bunny, James Cagney, Barbara Streisand accent, I'm from New York. But my parents would take me to Florida in my youth, about 1,400 miles south of New York, and to get there we would normally drive, and we would drive through the deep south. This was in the early 1960s, in the days of Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement. What South Africa called apartheid, the American South called segregation. It was reinforced by the Calvinistic Church. And I would see signs, giant billboards. This is Klan country, as in Ku Klux Klan. I never saw anything like this as a kid in New York. And I recall restaurants and hotels and things like that in the American South that would say, white only, white only. And this was something I was unfathomable to me. We didn't have this up in New York. I was just a little kid, and my parents were trying to explain to me what this was and why it was like this and how it went back to the American Civil War and slavery and so forth. And it was a mystery to me because my parents took me to see the jazz legend Louis Armstrong, a black man. And Louis Armstrong, even though he was a black man, he would be accepted by the white establishment. When Louis Armstrong or Duke Ellington or Nat King Cole or Ella Fitzgerald gave a concert in the American South, like in Atlanta or New Orleans, they'd have to give two concerts, one for the white people and one for the black people. Black people couldn't go see a black musician at the same concert as white people could go see a black musician. This was crazy to me. Louis Armstrong could go to any restaurant or hotel he wanted to because he was Louis Armstrong. Somehow, a black athlete or a black musician or black celebrity was expected to forget he was black because he could be accepted by the white establishment. Even though he was born black, he was accepted by the white establishment and he was supposed to turn a blind eye to segregation. Now, as a little kid, it was just too contradictory. There was no logic in it. And in those days, of course, of Calvinism, the churches were segregated in the American South. It was white-only churches. This was really crazy because the Calvinists were into this. Really crazy. Couldn't understand it. Well, Moses was in the same situation. He was born a Jew, but he was somehow expected to forget what he was. He was accepted by the Egyptian establishment. He was a member of the royal family, the royal court. He was an Egyptian general, aristocrat, prince, judge, etc. A black man can't forget he was born black. A Jew cannot forget he is born a Jew. And a Christian cannot forget they're born again. Your own identity will always be hammered home to you. But Moses had an encounter that taught him something that people forget. Unity can only come through new birth, not birth. Hebrew turned against Hebrew. He couldn't stop two Jews from killing each other. His own kind turned against him. And then Jew was fighting Jew. To this day, Israel, modern Israel, is a divided society. The Sephardic Jews don't get along with the Ashkenazi Jews. The religious Jews don't get along with the secular ones. The veteran Israelis and the native Israelis don't get along with the Russian immigrants. It's very much a divided society. It's only the common thread of Islam that creates an artificial unity. And so the Arabs are a divided society. Other Arabs hate the Palestinians, as they call themselves, the Jordanians. They wiped out between 15 and 18,000 of Arafat's people in 12 days in 1970 in Black September. They keep them in ghettos. They keep them in slums. The Egyptians, when the Egyptians controlled the Gaza Strip, they kept them in subhuman poverty. Under the Israelis, the standard of living of Palestinian Arabs, according to the United Nations World Health Organization, before the Intifada, went up 370%. In terms of infant mortality, longevity, unemployment, their economic and life expectancy, the standard of living quadrupled under the Israelis compared to what the Egyptians did to them, what happened under their own kind. The point is this. A common enemy does not create real unity. Without the Jew, Arab will turn against Arab. Without the Muslim, Jew will turn against Jew. Without the Pakeha, Maori will turn against Maori. It's just an illusion. Real unity can never come from birth, only from second birth. Man has fallen. People need to highlight or amplify a common enemy to create the illusion of some kind of a unity. That unity will never come about. People will always turn against each other. They can find the common enemy and use the common enemy to try to make themselves think they're one, but they're not one. They're not one. They're not one. It's all over the world, it's the same. Most crime in America, in the black community, is black on black. The Maori on Maori crime, and most Maori crime is committed against other Maoris. There's no unity because of birth. Unity only comes by new birth. People might try to masquerade it with a common enemy, but it doesn't work. Moses found that out. He found it out the hard way. And so he comes, rejected by his own kind. Who made you a prince and a judge over us? Off he goes, rejected by his own kind, rejected by the Egyptians, fleeing for his life into the wilderness of Midian. Midian is in northwest Saudi Arabia. It's the same place where the prophet Elijah fled to from Jezebel. It's the same place that St. Paul went to when he disappeared after he fled Damascus. It is not in the Sinai wilderness. The place people call Mount Sinai today is a tourist trap, St. Catherine's Monastery. It's important for its scriptorium and its library and its collection of codexes and manuscripts, but that's all. It's not the place where Moses was or where the burning bush was. It's basically a Greek Orthodox Church tourist trap. It's not where it was in Saudi Arabia. The book of Galatians tells us Mount Sinai is in Arabia. So Moses flees there, and you see this whole image of women by a well, women by a well accepting him. You see this with the patriarchs like Jacob. You see it with Jesus. Again, it's typology. It's the same imagery. And he's accepted. Why did you leave him? Bring him back to have something to eat. These people are living in a very, very hostile environment. It wasn't just a social invitation to dinner. Water and food were very precious commodities. He marries Zipporah, a Hebrew word for bird, and they have a son called Gershom. Ger is the modern Hebrew word, or the Hebrew word for a convert to Judaism is called a ger. There is a sojourner. There is a foreigner. Now this theme is reiterated in the New Testament. No matter what your national identity is, no matter what your ethnic identity is, we're to see ourselves as sojourners, as strangers in the earth. You may be an Aussie or a Kiwi or a Yank or a Brit or a Maori or a whatever. We are to see ourselves as sojourners on the earth. We're to bring our children up to know that this is not their real home, certainly not in its present state. The world has fallen. There is a foreigner, Gershom, and the story progresses. He spends 40 years in this wilderness. Now in chapter 3, verse 1, the story really takes off. It came about after the course of those many days, the king dies, of course, and the sons of Israel sighed because of the bondage, and their cry, and they cried out, and their cry for help because of their bondage rose up to God. So God heard their groanings, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Notice Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God saw the sons of Israel, and God took notice of them. Then it moves into second gear. Now Moses was pastoring the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Reuel's other name was Jethro. And he led the flock on the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb. Very often when you see God calling people to do great things, they have been shepherds. King David was a shepherd. The prophet Amos was a shepherd. Moses was a shepherd. All of them foreshadowed Jesus as the good shepherd in John chapter 10, as per the 23rd Psalm. They all foreshadow Christ. If you can look after his sheep, who can look after a few sheep can look after many. He who was faithful in little is faithful in much. The story then continues. He comes to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed. The reference to that would be, thou wilt not suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. The bush was not consumed. So Moses said, I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, why the bush is not burned up. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called out to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. The Hebrew word is hineni. And then he said, do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said also, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Now in chapter 2, it simply says, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Here it's the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Notice the detail. Then Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters. For I am aware of their sufferings. So I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians, to bring them up from that land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, halav v'dvash, to the place of the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Amorite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite. Now behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians are oppressing them. Therefore, come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly I will be with you, and this shall be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you've brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God at this mountain. Then Moses said to God, behold, I'm going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God furthermore said to Moses, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial name to all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has appeared to me saying, I am indeed concerned about you and what has been done to you in Egypt. So I said, I will bring you up of the affliction of Egypt, of the land of the Canaanites and the Hittite, the Amorite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, the Jebusite, to a land flowing with milk and honey. They will pay heed to what you say, and you with the elders of Israel will come to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. So please let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness to sacrifice to the Lord. But I know the king of Egypt will not permit you to go except under compulsion. You know the rest. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, is how it begins. And then he says, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Again it says, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And then it goes back to just, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. What's the difference? When the Old Testament says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the text is emphasizing the monotheistic oneness of God. When it says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the text is emphasizing the monotheistic oneness of God. When it says, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the text is emphasizing the triune oneness of God. The text is Trinitarian. You will find all three persons of the Trinity in the narrative. We see that the angel of the Lord speaks to him. In Hebrew, this is with the definite article, HaMelech Adonai, the angel of the Lord. Not an angel, but the angel. The angel of the Lord in Judaism is known as the Metatron. He has divine properties. He's the one who dwells at the center of the throne. Jacob wrestled not with an angel of the Lord, but with the angel of the Lord at Peniel at the brook of Jabbok. And he said, I saw the face of God. It was the angel of the Lord who appeared to Manoah, the parents of Samson. And it was the angel of the Lord who drove out the Canaanites in Judges chapter 1 and 2. The angel of the Lord is a Christophany, an Old Testament manifestation of Jesus. The angel of the Lord is a Christophany. So you have Yahweh, you have the angel of the Lord, the Metatron, the Christophany, and then you have the burning bush. The burning bush is the Shalchevet Yah, the flame of Yahweh. The Shekinah appeared as a pillar of fire. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. The Holy Spirit appeared in tongues of fire. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, monotheism. I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, Trinitarian. All three persons of the Trinity are there. Okay. Whenever you see salvation, you'll find all three persons. Jesus saves us. Nobody comes as the Father draws him, but the Holy Spirit must convict of sin. In the creation, you see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, according to Proverbs 8, John 1, and Genesis. When you look at them in light of each other, all three are involved in the creation. In John's Gospel, all three are involved in new creation. So too, all three are involved in saving Israel. All three. In the mentality of the ancient Near East, if you knew the name of a god or spiritual being, you'd have some kind of leverage or control over them. What is my name? Now, Moses says, I have to look upon this site. This site is why the bush is not consumed. Again, that will not suffer thy holy one to see corruption. It is wonderful. That word in Hebrew is not the ordinary word for wonderful, but it is a divine adjective called pele, pele, pele. A divine adjective is only ever used to describe God or to illustrate an attribute of God, pele. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, unto us a child is born, a son is given, the government will be upon his shoulder. His name will be Wonderful Counselor, Pele Yoetz. Mighty God, El Gabor, Everlasting Father, Avi Ad, and Prince of Peace, Sar Shalom. His name shall be called Pele Yoetz. Pele is never used for anyone to describe anyone other than God himself. He's seeing God. The text is obviously showing that the Metatron, the angel of the Lord, is divine. He speaks to him from the bush and says God spoke to him, yet it's the angel of the Lord. The text is Trinitarian and it's Pele. Now we have to understand what's really happening here in the Hebrew text. In Hebrew, you would never use the verb to be in the present tense except to indicate possession. For instance, in Hebrew, I wouldn't say, I have a bottle. I would say, there is to me a bottle. Yesh li bakbuk. I wouldn't say in Hebrew, I have a Bible. I would say, there is to me a Bible. Yesh li mikra. I wouldn't say, I have glasses. I would say, there is to me glasses. Yesh li mishkafayim. You'd never say, I am otherwise. For instance, in Hebrew, you wouldn't say, I am tired. You would just say, I tired. Ani ayef. You wouldn't say, I am cold. You would just say, I cold. Ani kar or karli. You wouldn't say, I am warm. You would just say, hamli or ani ham. I warm. Never I am. Never I am cold. Never I am thirsty. Never I am hungry. I would say, Shmi Yaakov. My name is Jacob. Or Ani Yaakov, I Jacob. But I couldn't say I am Jacob. In Hebrew, only God as I am. You understand? Only God as I am. Grammatically, the term does not exist except for God. Now in Greek, this would be ego ami. In John chapter 8, Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am, they pick up stones to stone him. Because by saying I am, you make yourself out to be God. In Hebrew, you never say I am unless you are. Okay? You never say I am unless you are. It would be blasphemy. So, who are you? What is your name? I am. Literally, it could be translated who was, who is to come. Okay? Asher haya hove ve'yavo. That's what it means, the tetragrammaton. Okay? But God calls Moses, and Moses says, Hineni. We translate Hineni, here I am, or here am I. That's more of an attempted transliteration. Hineni is what Isaiah said when God called Isaiah. Who shall I send to this people? Isaiah says, Hineni. It's easier to translate Hineni into French than it is English. In French, you might translate it, au votre service. Not simply, here I am, but what do you want me to do? Or when a general calls a soldier or a lesser ranking military officer and he says, yes, sir. Yes, sir doesn't simply mean here I am. It means what are my instructions? What are my orders? Hineni. So in the Hebrew text, you have a play on words. Moses, Moses, here am I. I want you to go to Pharaoh. Who am I? Wrong question. Who am I? I am who I am. Moses, Moses, here am I. I want you to go to Pharaoh, but who am I? No. Who am I? I am who I am. When God calls you to do something, when God calls me to do something, whenever God calls one of us to do something, the question is not who are we, but who is God? The question is always, who is God? He said, Hineni. 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 At every turning point in your life as a believer, or my life as a believer, we say Hineni to the Lord. When you were born again, you said Hineni, in effect. When you're baptized in water, you say, Hineni. Someone enters the ministry, they say, Hineni. At any turning point in someone's life, as a believer, they say, Hineni, in effect. Not just, here I am, but Lord, what are you leading me, directing me, guiding me to do?
Hineni.
What happens when you say Hineni? Lie one. It is the lie of the world. Moses was 40 years of age when he entered the wilderness and 80 when he came out. 40 when he went in, 80 when he came out. John wrote the book of Revelation when he was approximately 90. And Jacob gave his climactic prophecy in Genesis 49 when he was probably over 100. The lie? The lie is, it's a young person's world. It's managed by middle-aged people. And once you retire, get a shovel. That's the world. Unfortunately, too much of the church has bought into the lie of the world. God sees it differently. It's a young person's world. It's managed and controlled by middle-aged people. And when you're retired, that's it. This is the mentality of the world. It's also the mentality of the worldly church. It's what Hillsong is about. Okay. God sees it differently. God says, retirement, huh? So you've retired last Tuesday. Let me congratulate you on your retirement. Now you work for me full time. As far as God is concerned, everything else you did up to that point was preparation for now. Everything else you experienced was preparation for now. Okay, so up till now, I know you didn't have the time to spend praying hours. I know you didn't have the time to spend reading the Bible hours. You have the time now. I know you didn't have time to go out and knock on doors and give out gospel tracts and invite people to church next Sunday night to hear the gospel. You have that time now. Now you have the time. Up till now, you had a mortgage. Up till now, you had a trade, a profession, a business. Up till now, you had kids to put through law school or dental school. Up till now, you had a lot of pressures and responsibilities. You were stuck in traffic jams trying to get to work. You just did not have the time to spend doing what I wanted you to do. You couldn't, but you have the time now. That is how God views retirement. You don't retire from the ministry. Being a Christian is like being in the mafia. The only way you get out of the mafia is dressed in a concrete kimono. As long as health and mental health allow you to continue, you continue. God sees it quite differently. And you'll find that people who follow God's agenda for retirement instead of the world's are going to tend to have more longevity, to be mentally and physically healthier. I'm not saying they won't get ill. I'm not saying they won't lose the marbles. But on the average, those who follow God's agenda are going to do a lot better and last a lot longer. Just because they're going by his principles. Moses went in when he was 40. He comes out when he was 80. What equipped Moses to lead a whole nation of 1.5 million adults, plus their children, plus Egyptian stragglers, plus their cattle and livestock and so forth, and the treasures of Egypt they took with them? What equipped him to lead them 40 years through a very hostile wilderness from oasis to oasis? Because he spent 40 years in that same wilderness himself. This is what Paul means when he says, let the elders or the leaders be tested. It doesn't mean primarily passing Greek exams at a Bible college or seminary. That's good, but it's not good enough. It is, how did he stand during trials? What happened when his marriage was attacked? What happened when he faced financial difficulties? What happened when he faced crisis of health? How did he stand up in the face of persecution or opposition? Only once that person himself has survived by God's grace in the wilderness and learned to trust God in the wilderness can he be God's shepherd to guide and encourage other people through it. Let the leaders be tested. And so we begin with Moses. He says, Hineni. What happens when somebody says Hineni to the Lord. The first thing that happened to Moses when he said Hineni is the first thing that happens to everyone who really says Hineni and means it. Rejection. Rejection. Nobody who God is going to use has not experienced rejection. I don't just mean rejection by the Egyptians. He could have handled that. He was rejected by his own people. You don't know what rejection is till you're rejected by your own family, till you're rejected by the church. Then you understand rejection. But Moses learned to love the very people who rejected him. Just like Paul in 2 Timothy. He gave his life, his time, his guts for these people. And the very people he gave himself for rejected him. Can you love the people who reject you after you've done them good? That's the price of leadership. I don't mean love the wolves, but love the wayward sheep. Rejection. Why rejection? Why did he face rejection? Why do we face rejection? Why does anybody who God uses face rejection? There are three reasons. The first reason is, to be used of Christ, we must be Christ-like. Jesus loved the people who rejected him, but that's only the beginning. The Bible calls Jesus the rejected one of Israel. Isaiah describes him as one from whom men would turn their faces. We esteemed him not. To be used by Christ, we must be Christ-like. He was rejected. Despised and rejected of men, Isaiah said. One from whom as if men would turn their faces. Yet he loved them anyway. You cannot be used of Christ until you're Christ-like. Rejection. Second reason he faces rejection is when God was preparing Moses for the mission field, he was preparing the mission field for Moses. Moses was not yet ready to lead Israel. He had to spend 40 years in that same wilderness. 40 is the biblical number of divine testing. Jesus fasts 40 days and 40 nights. Moses fasts 40 days and 40 nights. Moses spends 40 years in the wilderness. The children of Israel sojourn 40 years in the wilderness. King David confronts Goliath at the Valley of Elah 40 days before he slays him. It rains 40 days and 40 nights in the epic of Noah, and so Jonah gives Nineveh 40 days to repent. 40 is the number of divine testing. While God was preparing Moses for the mission field, God was also preparing the mission field for Moses. Israel wasn't ready for him yet. When God is getting you ready to do what he has for you to do, he's also preparing the mission to be ready for you. The problem is we only see that in retrospect. We have to just accept it and trust it by faith. You can't see it except in retrospect. Just know that God's doing it. When you're in the wilderness, all you know is that you're in the wilderness. You don't see what God's doing until you come out. Third reason he's in the wilderness. This is a tough one. He was a big wheel. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 tells us, it is easier for poor people to be saved than rich ones. It's easier for simple people to be saved than clever ones. It is easier for uneducated people to be saved than educated ones. The more you have going for you by the standards of the fallen world, the more difficult it is to become a Christian because you have more things to trust in and hope in other than the eternal. It's easier for the simple to get saved than the clever, the poor than the rich, or the uneducated than the educated. Secondly, once somebody of position, means, education, status does get saved, they're going to have to experience a lot more of God's breaking. Because although there's nothing wrong with things like education or wealth, there's something wrong with us. Those things are natural grounds for pride and self-sufficiency. Those people will experience more of God's breaking in their life. A simple person, an uneducated person, a poor person, there's less to break. God can only use what he breaks and who he breaks. But there's less to break. You're a big wheel. There's a lot to be broken. Third reason, that's the big one. But also, where much is given, much is expected. Not only is it harder for a rich person to get saved, an educated person to get saved, a clever person to get saved, but once they do, God expects more out of them. His values are always in diametric contrast to the fallen world, always. God's values always stand in diametric opposition to the world, always. The first thing that happens, rejection. Rejection. To be used by Christ, you have to be Christ-like. To learn to love the ones who reject you. Rejection. Second thing that happens, exile to the wilderness. It may not be a literal wilderness, but you'll go through this long period of your life where you don't understand what God is doing. Why are you stuck in that lousy situation? When's it ever going to get better? When is it ever going to change? Lord, why don't you get me out of here? So often we see the same motif again of exile to the wilderness. Let's look at a couple of figures. Let's look at one from the old and one from the new. From the Old Testament, we have King David. King David, chosen by God, a descendant of Ruth and Boaz. The lineage of the Messiah would come from David. The prophet Samuel himself anoints him as king. Even when he's a little kid, God's hand is on him. He slays Goliath. He killed Goliath when he was a kid. He's a direct descendant of Ruth and Boaz. He was anointed by Samuel himself. Well, what happens to King David? Rejection. Rapidly followed by exile. Exile to the wilderness, in his case, the wilderness of Zin, the area to the west of the Dead Sea, where he encounters Saul at the cave of En Gedi. On his way to the wilderness in his state of rejection, he stops at the cave of Adullam. And it says, all who are in debt, the outcasts of Israel, join themselves to David. Every loser, every nobody, every nothing who was maxed out on their credit cards joined themselves to David. It's always easier for the have-nots than the haves. Now, the house of Saul, even guys like Jonathan, they knew their old man was no good. They knew Saul was a backslider. They knew how bad their father was. But they also knew which side of the bread the butter was. It's the same today. It's the same today. I know plenty of ministers and denominations that have gone into error and deception, into ecumenism and into the gold dust or whatever the latest flavor of the month is. They've gone into all this rubbish, knowing it was rubbish, but they stay loyal to the system, knowing it's no good. I know plenty of guys in the Baptist Assemblies of God, they know this stuff is wrong, but they stay in it. Privately, they'll agree with a Dave Hunt or a Philip Powell or a Bill Randles or even a yours truly, privately. Push comes to shove, which side of the bread is the butter on? Just like the sons of Saul. But the single parents who get saved and who just love the Lord and trust Jesus for enough money to pay the electric bill, they have nothing to lose. They have nothing to lose. The outcasts of Israel join themselves to David at the cave of Adullam. The nobodies, the nothings. It's the way it is. Just like in the days of Nehemiah, the nobles, few of the nobles joined themselves to the work. However, these down and out, nobody, nothing losers are described quite differently later on. On their way into the wilderness, they're described as nobody, nothing losers. They're all broke. But when they come out of the wilderness, they're called David's mighty men. Not only are they called David's mighty men, they're called commanders of the army. Not simply commanders of the army of Israel, but the commanders of the army of the Lord. Where does God take a nobody, nothing loser, a down and out nothing, an uneducated person of no means or status, and turn them into a general? Where does God take a nobody, nothing loser, and make him a general in God's army? Does God send them to West Point? They didn't have any West Point, and even if they did, they wouldn't be clever enough to get in. Does he send them to the Royal Military Academy at Sandhurst in England? No, they didn't have any Sandhurst, but they had plenty of sand. He sent them to the wilderness. Then, of course, there was Rabbi Shaul of Tarsus, another big wheel, better known as Paul the Apostle, a Pharisee of the Pharisees, a disciple of Rabbi Gamaliel, the grandson of Rabbi Hillel himself. And on top of that, not only a big wheel among the Jews, he was a big wheel among the Romans. He was a Roman citizen, a big deal in those days. Whoa. He used to ride with the hunters, now he's running with the foxes. Yeah, Jesus revealed himself to me, knocked me clean off the horse. Now I know he's the Messiah. I'm a big wheel rabbi. I'm a Pharisee. I'm a disciple of Gamaliel. I'm an expert in Midrash. I'm a Roman citizen. I speak Greek. I speak Latin. I speak Hebrew and Aramaic. Where's the synagogue? I'll straighten these Jews out. I'll show them he's the Messiah. I used to arrest and persecute Jews for believing in Jesus. Now I know he's our Messiah. Where's the synagogue? Oh, his motives were right. Moses' motives were right. Rejection. Out the wall through a hole in Damascus. Out the window on a basket. And he disappears for years. The book of Galatians tells us where he disappears to. Arabia. What's Arabia? The wilderness. It's the desert. Shows up later in Antioch with Barnabas. Years later. Rejection. Exile. I remember when I said Hineni to the Lord. I wouldn't put myself in the same league with Moses, David, or Paul the Apostle, but I certainly had the same experience. I said that word, Hineni. I had a problem. The problem was the words of my favorite rabbi. My favorite rabbi said, where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. My favorite rabbi was Rabbi Yeshua Bar Yosef Minetzedet, better known as the Lord Jesus Christ. Where your heart is, your treasure will be also. I was not a lukewarm Christian. I did evangelism on the streets of New York with Jews for Jesus. I didn't get angry when old Jewish ladies would spit on me and tell me how no good I was. I would do volunteer work in the rescue mission run by my church, the down and outs, the homeless, alcoholics, drug addicts, teenage prostitutes. I didn't care. I'd get my hands dirty in the work of the Lord. But I had a problem. I was just a kid, and I was loaded. Made a couple of grand a week. A lot of money in those days. I mean, American. Back in the early 70s, it was a lot of money. Young person is 20s, thousands of dollars a week. A lot of money. Not boasting about it, but I was well on my way to becoming a millionaire. I was just a kid. First time in my life I ever made a lot of money legitimately. And although I was committed to the Lord, there were certain contradictions. I enjoyed writing checks to mission organizations. I was quite generous with my money. Poor and missions, evangelism. But I love my holidays in Switzerland. I love dinners at the 21 Club in Manhattan. I love being able to speak for hours on the telephone to my girlfriend, presently my wife, who lived in Israel. I lived in New York. I love traveling around the world, doing what I wanted to do. Had it pretty good. Until the Lord told me to immigrate to Israel and bring the good news back home again and witness to Jews and Arabs who didn't want to hear it. Of course, I had a lot of reasons to tell God otherwise. Listen, there's more Jews in Queens than there is in Tel Aviv. And look at Romans 12. Let he who gives give liberality. There's a gift of philanthropy. I mean, somebody's got to write these checks, Lord, you know. I had my arguments laid out. Where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. To make a very long story very short, God had his way, but I experienced God's breaking. Maybe someday he'll restore the fortunes of Judah, I don't know. But if he does, my attitude towards money will be very different. So off I was to the promised land, and it was not all I'd been promised. Now I had a family, and I had to earn a living. So I had a couple of choices. One was, I had studied medicine as a kid. One was just go back, qualify as a physician. Didn't want to do that because I was there for ministry. That takes a lot of time and work. So I just did the only thing I could do. I filled prescriptions for a living. That's what I did. I filled prescriptions. It was 5% medicine and pharmacology, 95% filling out forms and explaining to old ladies in Yiddish how many to take because they didn't know Hebrew. Was in an Orthodox Jewish neighborhood. The yeshiva boys used to come in with thick glasses. They wanted eye drops. Only little kid that had to study in the heder all day long. And then, of course, Orthodox Jews are supposed to have, especially the Hasidim, it's a mitzvah to have as many babies as possible in case one's the Messiah. All I had to do was photocopy the prescriptions for birth control pills. I could have blackmailed half the neighborhood. The only thing they took more of than birth control pills was their husbands. They took Valium. And I was leading a little congregation. Little. I began teaching evangelistic Bible studies to Israeli young people on a kibbutz. And working and trying to run a congregation with my friend. And on top of that, on the other side of the wall was the Yad Lachim, the anti-mission organization. So one of these days, these guys are going to catch me. Something. It's one thing to know about Hasidic Jews. When I was going to move to Israel, I read all about Hasidic Judaism, and I knew them from New York. But I didn't know about them. I knew them. I was in that neighborhood every day for years. And I went on and on and on. What am I doing here? I left the bright lights of Broadway for this. I left Manhattan for this. There's a Yiddish word called kvetch. Kvetch, not a Hebrew word, a Yiddish word. Kvetch means to complain. Kvetch, kvetch, and I would kvetch. What am I doing? Filling prescriptions? I thought when I got saved, my days of selling drugs were over. Before I knew the Lord, I subsidized my cocaine habit by dealing cocaine. I was dealing acid even when I was in high school, LSD. Now I'm back to selling drugs. Terrible. I thought I was going to get cleaned up. Maybe be a neuroendocrinologist, work in biomedical research. Now look what I'm doing here. I felt like I was wasting my life. I hated it. It was terrible. Kvetch, kvetch, kvetch. And I remember I was hanging out one day, kvetching, and I looked out the window. And there was sand out there. Why was there sand, do you ask? No, it wasn't a beach. It was a desert. And I was living in it. When I got saved, my old man pulled a piece on me. All right, rejection. But now, the wilderness, in my case, literally. When you're in that wilderness, you don't know what God is doing. You just know you want to get out of there. But it goes on and on. Preacher, I was a preacher. My thing was evangelism. I didn't know about expounding the Bible. My background was science. I studied theology later in England. I didn't know about this. I just knew about evangelism. But there was nobody in Israel to teach the scriptures, so I began doing it. One thing led to another. I didn't know what I was doing, but God did. Well, I knew what I was doing. I was fetching. God was doing something different. The wilderness. Rejection, the wilderness. If you want to serve God, the first thing that will happen is you're going to be rejected. And I don't just mean by the world. Who cares? They're unsaved. We shouldn't pay attention to them anyway. They don't know anything. Unsaved people, they don't understand things of eternal consequence anyway. What do you want to pay attention to them for? Who cares what they think? They're not even saved. They don't know anything. But when you're rejected by the church, by other believers, by your family, that hurts. That comes with a price. And then to add insult to injury, to put salt into the wound, there you are in the wilderness. 40 years in the case of Moses. But then the third thing happens. The burning bush. God speaks to you. Something happens. God speaks to you. It's a revelation. Then you begin to understand what he was doing, what he was saying. God has spoken. Take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. And when God speaks, once again, you say, Hineni. Only this time, you understand the full depth of what you're saying. What will the sign be, Lord? Because the whole nation will worship me at this same mountain. No matter how gifted someone is, no matter how called of God someone is, no matter how anointed someone may be in the genuine sense of the word anointing, no matter how gifted, how anointed, how called, no matter, it doesn't matter. You can never lead others to a place in the Lord you have not been to yourself. You could never lead others to a place in the Lord you have not been to yourself. This will be the sign. The whole nation will worship at this mountain. You see, even though it's the same person, even though it's precisely the same individual, the man or the woman who comes out of that wilderness is entirely different in character and demeanor than the one who went in. The Moses who went into that wilderness was a big wheel, and he knew it. I am a prince and a judge of Egypt. I am a general in the Egyptian army. I am the grandson of Pharaoh. I am a prince. I am a big wheel. I am an aristocrat. I was educated in Pharaoh's academies, private tutors. I'm a man of wealth and position. stop oppressing my fellow Hebrew. His motive was right. His source of strength was wrong. The man who went into the wilderness couldn't inspire two Hebrews. In fact, he couldn't even inspire one. But the man who came out could inspire a nation. He said, "Me?" God said, "Yes, now the elders are going to listen to you." Because his source of strength was not in himself. But who am I? Who am I? The Moses who went in said, "I'm the prince, here am I." The Moses who comes out says, "Who am I? I can't do this. Who am I?" God says, "No. Wrong, Moses. Who am I? I am who I am." You see, the man or the woman who goes into the wilderness knows their strength. The one who comes out, rather, knows their weakness, that they may instead know the strength of God, whose strength is magnified in our weakness. The one who goes into the wilderness knows their strength. The one who comes out knows their weakness, that they may rather know the strength of God. The one who goes in knows who they are. But the one who comes out knows who they aren't. The one who goes in are confident what they can do. The one who comes out only knows what they can't do, unless God does it through them. The one who goes in can't really inspire others. He may have the credentials and the position, but he doesn't have the God-given power. I wish there was a Bible college or a seminary that could teach these things to people, but there is no Bible college or seminary that can teach these things to people. I do not berate theological education. There are good ones and bad ones. There are good institutions and ones that aren't so good. In New Zealand, there's a serious shortage of good ones. I went to what is academically a pretty good one. I have a good theological education. They taught me a lot of good things. They taught me a great deal about the Bible. But only God can teach you what the Bible is about. A good Bible college, a good seminary can teach you about the Bible. But only God can teach what the Bible is about. Passing exams in Greek and Hebrew, all that stuff is good. Literary criticism, apologetics, that stuff is good. But it's not good enough. And then God says to Moses, "What do you mean, how can you go to Pharaoh? You're a prince of Egypt. You know his language, his culture, his customs. You were a general in Pharaoh's army. You were a prince of Egypt, a judge of Egypt. You were an Egyptian aristocrat. That was my hand on you all of your life. It was my hand that saw that you were the Jewish baby who survived. It was my hand that caused you to be put into that floating basket," as we mistranslate. "I'm the one who saw to it that you had the finest education Pharaoh could provide. I'm the one who saw to it that you became a general, a judge, and a prince. I'm the one who made you an Egyptian aristocrat. That was my hand. Now that you've learned to trust me and not all that stuff, now I'm going to use your education. Now I'm going to use your human background and experience. Now I can use that stuff. Because before now, you were trusting that stuff. Now you trust me. Now I can use it." That's the way it is. That's the way it always is. That's the way it has to be. That's the way it was for Moses. That's the way it was for King David. That's the way it was for Rabbi Shaul of Tarsus and even That's the way it was for me, and that's the way it is for you. Rejection, wilderness, burning bush. Can you love the people who reject you? I don't mean the wolves, but the sheep. When you're in that wilderness, can you trust God when nothing seems to be working out and it goes on and on, year after year, day after day? What is going on? Why, Lord, don't you use me instead of abuse me? And alas, the burning bush. Here am I. Hine me. That's what it comes to. Hine me. In these last days, God is not looking for people who will mindlessly babble out cliches. We have cliche Christianity today. He's not looking for people who will mindlessly sing choruses, the lyrics of which are not even biblical in many cases. He's not looking for people to follow hype artistry, deception, con artistry. He's looking for people who are going to follow him. People who will make a difference. People willing to accept God's plan for their lives, knowing there'll be an element of rejection. A season of exile. But alas, voila, the burning bush. When they'll be able to bring others to a place in the Lord only because they've been there themselves. That's the way it is. That's what it takes. Hineni. Hineni. Don't say it to me. Don't say it to the person next to you. And above all, don't say it if you don't mean it. But if you do mean it, we'll say it on three. Achad, shtayim, shalosh. One, two, three. Hineni. Once more. One, two, three. God bless. See you when you get back from the wilderness.